Oklahoma Gardening is a production of the Oklahoma Cooperative Extension Service as part of the land-grant mission of the Division of Agricultural Sciences and Natural Resources at Oklahoma State University, dedicated to improving the quality of life of the citizens of Oklahoma through research-based information. Southwood Landscape and Garden Center, Tulsa's source for great gardens. SouthwoodGardenCenter.com. And the Oklahoma Department of Agriculture, Food, and Forestry, helping to keep Oklahoma green and growing.
We are behind the scenes planning for next season. In the meantime, we hope you enjoy some of our favorite shows from this last year.
On today's show, OSU entomologist Andrina Shufran explains how mason bees are different from honeybees and has a simple project to attract these wonderful pollinators to your garden. Host Casey Hinches takes a walk with OSU Extension rain specialist Laura Goodman to look at summer blooming wildflowers. And we create a home for our bluebirds.
About bees, do we really know what we're talking about? Joining us is Dr. Shufran here at the Insect Zoo and an entomologist with Oklahoma Cooperative Extension. And Dr. Shufran, you're going to talk to us about the differences between mason bees and honeybees. A lot of times we think honeybees are the most important, but
There are a lot of other bees out there. In the United States, there are 4,000 at least different species of bees. Mm-hmm. And a lot of those are solitary bees that are doing a great deal of work, where honeybees are a big colony, so they're more interested in their whole group together.
Okay.
So honeybees are imported, they're not native, and our mason bees and leafcutter bees are all from this area, they're adapted to this area. They work really hard, some statistics say twice as hard as honeybees do to pollinate, so they're super important.
Okay, so and behind us we have a mason bee home that you've created, an insect hotel, basically.
Yeah, definitely.
And so what is it that is basically the difference in a home with a honeybee versus a mason bee?
Sure, when most people think of bees, they think of honeybees. Mm-hmm. So they imagine that bees all live in a big hive together, and it's a little square box, and you can pull the plates out and
right.
the whole nine yards. But most bees live by themselves in a single location, and they lay their eggs separate from all the other bees around.
Okay.
So with the mason bee house that we've built here, it's actually not just for mason bees, but for any of the little solitary bees. And so we've drilled holes and provided holes of all different shapes and sizes so that bees can pick which hole they want to live in and make their nest cavity for their larvae.
Okay.
And what's cool about this, what's so amazing about bees, is the mama mason bee will pick a hole and she'll go in and she'll clean it out and she will go way to the back and she'll lay an egg. And then she'll go get food for it, and she'll pack it in around the egg.
And what is the food when you...
Some of them are, depending on the solitary bee, some of them are predatory, and they'll pick up little spiders or little caterpillars and those sort of things. They're also, they'll feed on pollen, and that's a protein source, so that helps the larva to grow.
So they pack that in egg.
And then they put mud over it, so it's like a little cell all by itself. And they do that over and over again till they get to the front, and then they seal it off extra good.
So one hole could have several eggs in it.
Yeah, it could have 7 or 8 all in a row.
Okay.
And then once she's got that filled up, she'll go and make more and more holes until she dies. But what's so cool is that instead of the first one that was laid hatching first, the last one that was laid hatches first and eats her way out. And then the second one eats her way out. So it's in reverse order from how they were laid in there.
Huh.
And nobody knows how they can do that.
So when we see some of those holes that are covered over, are those eggs in there?
Yeah, those holes that we have drilled are about 5 inches long.
Mm-hmm.
So they'll probably hold anywhere from 4 to 8 cells. And right now, all the ones that you can see that are plugged are the ones that have larvae in them that are growing and eating and hopefully will soon emerge. If they look really bright and fresh, that's for sure this year's.
Okay.
Some of them will look kind of dull and sort of caved in. Those are last year's. We even had some that were alive and working in late fall, October, November. We were still seeing some of the bees going out. So they go almost all year round. If they fill up all of those, what we can do is go through with a pipe cleaner. And when in the middle of the winter, when everything's dead, we can clean all those out and they'll start them again.
Okay, all right.
We don't have to drill all new holes. We just have to tidy the house and they'll come back.
Get out some of that remaining food and mud and things like that.
Exactly. And some of the larger holes are for larger species of bees. And then some of the smaller holes would be for the really small sweat bees and tiny bees that you get. We have such a diversity of bees, you just wouldn't believe.
If you wanted to build your own insect hotel, what are some factors you want to consider?
Great. There are several that you need to keep in mind. Bees are very picky about which direction they like their holes to open towards. They like to face the holes east. So you want everything facing towards the east, and that protects them from the late afternoon sun, gives them morning sun and keeps them cool in the afternoon. They don't like to be down near the ground because those are predators and ants and things that will bother them. So the hotels should be about 4 feet and up, and they can go up as high as you feel comfortable with. And then the size of the hole, you want to be from a quarter of an inch all the way through to a half inch with every little increment in between. So you have to buy a whole new drill set, which makes every man happy.
There you go. Now, what about the plants that are related, you know, to the bees? Are they the same sort of pollinator plants you would use for bees across the, you know, honeybees and solitary bees, or would you use something different?
If you're planning to make a garden that's going to be happy for bees, that's going to be most attractive, for native bees, then you want to use native plants. A honeybee will pretty much take anything that it likes and it looks good. These guys are more programmed to recognize things that have always been here, that they've sort of grown up with over the millennia. And then they're also very good at garden pollination for fruits and vegetables, those sort of things, because most of those flowers are fairly large and nonspecific, so they can get in there and collect the pollen as well as any other bee. And that gives you more fruit, more tomatoes, more squash.
Thank you for sharing this information on bees.
My pleasure.
As Oklahomans, we can't help but notice the beautiful wildflowers that are blooming in the spring. And I know as a gardener, I'm always looking at the beautiful flowers and trying to figure out what they are. Joining us today is Dr. Laura Goodman, who is an Extension Range Specialist with the Natural Resource Ecology and Management Department. And this is your specialty, is range management. Can you first tell us what range really is? I mean, it's behind us here, but what is the definition of range?
So range is really just land that isn't cultivated for any use. And so we typically find these lands in areas that have either sandy soils or rocky soils, or there's some reason that land isn't suitable for growing crops. These lands typically have native vegetation, so they're going to have native plants. And so that's what we're going to look at today, is the wildflowers that you might find in a pasture that has a native range system.
Yeah, because a lot of these plants are becoming popular within the horticulture industry, and they're sold commercially, like this one here in front of us. This is Baptisia. Can you tell us about kind of what it means to find it out in the range and maybe what it tells you about the land here?
So you're right, this is Baptisia. Wild blue indigo is what some people call it. This plant is really well adapted to almost any kind of soil, so you could find it across the state. It is in the pea family. It's a legume, and so these plants are really important as seed sources for turkey, bobwhite quail. They're all going to consume the seeds after these have put on their pods.
Laura, there's so much diversity out here. It looks like we've got some primrose here. Is this primrose?
So it looks quite a bit like primrose. So there's a showy evening primrose that you see a lot along the ditches. It's a purple flower that you see. This is actually light poppy mallow, so it's in a different family. But it looks a lot like that showy evening primrose.
Oh, okay. All right. And here is the Rallis gallardia.
Yeah.
I love this one.
This is such a neat plant. So this gallardia is really similar to Indian blanket. It's just missing those petals or the ray flowers that Indian blanket has. So here we have another one that's related to that light poppy mallow. This is also in the mallow family, and it's called cowboy rose or wine cup. And it gets the name wine cup from that real rich color that it has on the petals. Mm-hmm. It has five petals generally, and this is a trailing plant, and so it'll trail along the ground, but it doesn't put roots down as it trails. Here's the leaves, you can see they're real distinctive, lobed and kind of hand-shaped leaves. This plant has a carrot-like tuber underground, and so if you already had it in your garden, you could spread it to different areas by digging up that and spreading it and planting it in another area. Otherwise, you can always buy seed. They're definitely available commercially.
So. Definitely one that pops in all the green here.
Oh, yeah.
Well, let's go see what else we can find.
Okay. So, Casey, here we have beard tongue penstemon. And this, we have a couple of different penstemon that grow in Oklahoma. This one and Oklahoma penstemon are ones that you'll commonly see. Oklahoma penstemon has smaller flowers than this and more linear leaves. These have a little bit broader leaf, but these beard tongue penstemon sure are beautiful.
Those are gorgeous. I would imagine hummingbirds would like those and like that with that tubular flower.
Yeah, definitely.
We've got a few others around here too.
All right.
And it looks like a Mexican hat. I mean,
These
are some of the ones that we have in horticulture.
Yeah. So another another plant that has kind of a cone flower here with the petals down below, and then it has that real distinct leaves with the deep lobes that you can see here.
So Laura, a lot of these that we've looked at are herbaceous wildflowers. Are there any shrubs that are of value and importance?
Yeah, there's some that are flowering right now.
Oh, let's go look.
Okay.
It looks like a dogwood.
Yeah, so it is a dogwood. You know, these shrub species are really important in rangelands. They provide cover for deer, for quail, for turkey, for all sorts of different wildlife species. And so, you know, dogwood, plum, these are sumac, these are all really important to keep in our rangeland systems and have, you know, at least small areas that have thick, woody cover, you know, to protect them from different predators, especially some of these ground nesting birds from hawks and owls, that kind of thing.
So I saw another one that we see a lot in the landscape industry, the buttonbush.
Yeah, so buttonbush is another really important cover plant for wildlife species, and you'll see it in rangelands, especially sometimes around water.
Okay, because in the landscape industry, we tend to use it in wet areas as well. Mm-hmm. So it's fascinating, and thank you for sharing with us, you know, the value of plants both in rangeland and also how we use them in the horticulture industry as well.
Yeah.
I want to also mention to our viewers that it's important not to go out into the rangeland and dig these up.
Yeah, definitely.
A lot of them won't transplant well because of the taproot and stuff, correct?
Yeah, so a lot of these plants is really best to just start from seed. You know, when you transplant them from the native environment that they're in, sometimes it's an adjustment with the soils, changes in soils, and the taproots can be damaged fairly easily. So you're right.
And most of them are so available commercially that there's really no point to do that. Well, thank you for joining us and sharing this with us, Dr. Goodman.
Thank you.
Eastern bluebird is a very common and enjoyable native songbird throughout most of Oklahoma. Creating a bluebird trail is a very fulfilling and enjoyable pastime. I'd like to share some tips for creation of your own bluebird trail. Here we have a standardized eastern bluebird box for north central Oklahoma, and you see an 1.5-inch diameter hole in the box. I've chosen as a predator guard here hardware cloth, and there's also a latching system to keep the box from opening accidentally. And I encourage a double latching system. I'm going to pull the pin on the latches here so that even if one of these pins came out, the door is still secured by another pin. So we pull this second pin, and remember you have to account for your wire predator guard if you're going to use one. You want to be able to easily check the box, mount it at a height that's convenient for you or your children to check, so that you can check it on the order of every 3 to 4 days. Now, once we know that a box is being used, we want to approach it very carefully. The females lay the eggs in the morning, so we never want to flush them off the nest when they might be egg laying. So when you suspect that egg laying is going to be occurring, you want to visit in the afternoons. Also, we don't want to visit too late in the afternoon or evening, because if you flush the bird right before darkness, it might not return that night and the eggs would possibly get too cold and die. So those are some tips regarding when you should check the box. When approaching the box, when you suspect egg laying or the female to be in or near, you want to make some noise to let them know that you're in the area so you don't accidentally open the box and absolutely startle them. When you mount your boxes on a bluebird trail, and a trail consists of two or more boxes, make sure that you have at least 100 yards between each of the nest boxes. That way you'll reduce the chance of males fighting over the same territory. You'll again want to check the boxes on the order of every 3 to 4 days. After a clutch has fledged from the nest, you'll want to remove the nest and clean it completely out. You may notice a lot of bird mites in there. That's okay, because removal of the old nest helps to decrease the time for which those mites are in there. I also like a few flowers of organic sulfur placed in the box as a mite deterrent, and I use that upon the cleaning of every box. So with these tips, you can help make this wonderful Oklahoma cavity nester a nice home and encourage it to bring some beauty and peace of mind to your area. Let's next talk about construction of bluebird boxes. The basic cavity floor pan needs to be approximately 4 by 4 inches or greater in size, with a depth of cavity of 8 up to 11 inches. The birds aren't particularly choosy within those specifications. In terms of materials, you're going to be putting some effort into construction of the box, so we like to choose a material that's going to be around for several years. The least expensive materials are those that unfortunately will break down the most quickly. I do want to specify, though, that we stay away from pressure-treated lumber, which can fight the effect of bacteria and fungi, but might in fact be toxic to the birds. Here we see an example of pressure-treated pine. We want to avoid using this material at all costs. However, these are standard 6-foot planks, dog-eared planks that are used for privacy fences. They actually come in at $2 or under per plank. So these would require several years of weathering before they would be safe for the birds to use. What I prefer to use is Western Red Cedar, and it's still affordable, and the most widely affordable are those Western Red Cedar planks that are used in privacy fence construction. So these actually have a measurement of about 3/4 inch thick by 5.5 inches wide, but their specifications say 1 inch by 6 inches, but you're going to lose 1/2 inch in width of board and also 1/4 inch in the thickness of the board. And these come in either a 5-foot or a 6-foot length. And the Noble Foundation actually has planned specifications for bluebird box construction where you can get one box per 5 or 6-foot plank. Now, this plank here is also of Western Red Cedar, and what you see is a brand new Western Red Cedar plank versus a plank that's 1 year of age, so they do start to weather with time. I want to show you an example of a Eastern Red Cedar box, and this particular box is about 22 years old, and it's ready to be repaired at this point. The good thing about standardizing your boxes, I will say, is that you'll be able to come in and part in those parts that degrade or wear out over time. So that's the good thing about choosing a style of box and sticking with it over time. Another construction material is the Eastern Red Cedar. So this box is a purchased box available at many of the large box stores, and these can usually be purchased for under $10. And this is Eastern Red Cedar or Aromatic Cedar as opposed to Western Red Cedar. So either one of these construction materials is suitable. You can even use standard pine wood as long as it's not pressure treated. And actually, I've been able to get 10 years out of regular non-treated pine if it's not in a particularly wet environment. You'll pick up a few more years of useful life if you'll do a whitewashing with a latex paint. You can even dilute it at 50% with water. But I discourage the use of roofing compounds or elastomeric compounds. I've actually had a bad experience where I sealed the box so tightly that it couldn't breathe and the box actually rotted, even though I thought I was doing a good job. The opening of the box is extremely important with Eastern Bluebirds. What we're striving to get is an inch and a half opening. That's going to keep the introduced starling from being able to get into the box and use it. Starlings and house sparrows also known as English sparrows, are the biggest threats to the cavity nesting Eastern Bluebird. And so we're going to not exceed an inch and a half in diameter for the hole used for the opening of the Bluebird box. Now what's important also is that the hole won't stop the common house sparrow, but the hole stops not only the starling, but it also reduces the incidence of raccoon and feral domestic cats being able to get in there. But if you'd really like to put an extra whammy to keep the predators from being able to get in there, we use a predator guard where the hole's cut to the same size as in the box. And what I actually like is the hardware cloth predator guard because it somewhat discourages snakes. It's not 100% deterrent, but it keeps raccoons and also house cats from being able to articulate their arm and get in there. With the screws of the hardware cloth to the box, this actually will hold the weight of a raccoon and keep them from getting in there. And it'll certainly keep a house cat from getting in there. Those are two predators that love to raid bluebird box nests of not only little birds, but also the eggs. And this will help deter snakes, but it's not a 100% thorough deterrent. There are some other deterrents that can be put on the post of the boxes. Now the mounting height of boxes is very important. Usually you can put them between 4 foot and any height that you'd like. But I encourage you to use a height that's convenient to you that will allow you to check the box without being uncomfortable. So mount it to a height that's comfortable to your height. For instance, I'm about 5'7" and I like to place it so that I can easily look inside the nest boxes, and I'm able to check them on a 3 to 4 day basis. That's what the biologists recommend with the checking of the boxes, so you can log what's going on with the boxes. And also we encourage you to participate in the Oklahoma Department of Wildlife, their annual Bluebird Survey. You can download their form from the internet, and we'll share that address with you so that you can share your data from Eastern Bluebird nesting with the Department of Wildlife.
There are lots of great horticultural events this time of year. Be sure and consider these activities when you're making your plans for the weeks ahead. Next week on the Best of Oklahoma Gardening, we'll be revisiting the beautiful homes from our 2017 Viewer's Garden Contest. We'll see you then for more TV you'll grow to love. To find out more information about show topics, as well as recipes, videos, articles, fact sheets, and other resources, including a directory of local extension offices, be sure and visit our website, oklahomagardening.okstate.edu. And we always have great information, answers to questions, photos, and gardening discussions on your favorite social media as well. Join in on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. You can find this entire show and other recent shows, as well as individual segments, on our Oklahoma Gardening YouTube channel. And tune in to our OK Gardening Classics YouTube channel to watch segments from previous hosts. Oklahoma Gardening is produced by the Oklahoma Cooperative Extension Service as part of the Division of Agricultural Sciences and Natural Resources at Oklahoma State University. The Botanic Garden at OSU is home to our studio gardens, and we encourage you to come visit this beautiful Stillwater jewel. We wish to thank our generous underwriters, Southwood Landscape and Garden Center, and the Oklahoma Department of Agriculture, Food, and Forestry. Additional support is provided by Pond Pro Shops, Greenleaf Nursery and the Garden Debut Plants, and the Oklahoma Horticultural Society. Hope you enjoyed this video. It's part of our Oklahoma Gardening YouTube channel. You can also find even more videos on our OK Gardening Classics YouTube channel. And join us on social media for great gardening tips, photos, and discussions.